with a random act of love. Everything we do is.
Welcome to Every Church, a Peace Church, a program that promotes the belief that the church could turn the world towards peace if the church lived and taught as Jesus lived and taught. My name is Don Edwards. I'm the host and producer of this program. And today we are in store for a treat. Our guest today is Reverend Emmanuel Charles McCarthy, a Catholic priest, who is formerly a teacher at Notre Dame and now is presently rector of St. Gregory Byzantine Catholic Seminary in Boston, Massachusetts. Father McCarthy is a Nobel Peace Prize nominee and co-founder of Pax Christi USA, a international Catholic-led peace organization. Father McCarthy is an author, a scholar, a peacemaker. One of the books that he has written is Christian Just War Theory, The Logic of Deceit. All things flee thee, for thou fleest me, a cry to the churches and their leaders to stop running from the nonviolent Jesus and his nonviolent way. And also a book called August 9th, discussing the Nagasaki horror. Father McCarthy is an outspoken peacemaker, and we're going to make this a two-part program. This is one of two parts. We're going to do two shows because Father McCarthy has too much to say, too much to give to us for one 30-minute show. So this is going to be part one. Next week, we'll show part two of this interview. Father McCarthy, welcome.
Thank you, Don.
To Every Church, a Peace
Thank
Church.
You.
And I'm so glad to have you here and coming from Boston to share with us your long experience working with the nonviolent Jesus, particularly in the Christian community.
Well, I find it, Don, quite meaningful to be here because this is one of the few forums that I know of, having been at this for 35 years, where this subject, the nonviolent Jesus of the gospel and his way of nonviolent love of friends and enemies, can actually get a microphone in any of the major churches of Christianity. So for me, it's a very, very meaningful experience.
Well, I'm proud to have you because when I listened to you the first time at one of your seminars, it was a stirring experience. And I said, well, this man needs to be with me in this chair to discuss what your view, your vision, your history, your perspective of the nonviolent Jesus. Father McCarthy, we begin this show program with the motto of Every Church, a Peace Church, that the church could turn the world towards peace if the church lived and taught as Jesus lived and taught. Do you agree to that?
I would say that I agree to it with one exception, and that is, it's not that the church could turn the world, the church would turn the world.
Mm.
Christ is risen. The church is supposed to be an extension in time and space of the risen Christ. The power of God is in the risen Christ and therefore is in the church. However, in order for that power to be released in history, to conquer evil, to have its effects on ignorance and devastation and destruction that is part of the mystery of iniquity, the one thing that's needed is fidelity to the Lord. And one cannot be faithful to Jesus by doing what Jesus says not to do. And that's exactly what the churches have been doing, Catholic, Protestant, Orthodox, and Evangelical, since approximately the time of Constantine, 1700 years ago. They have been justifying in the name of Jesus what Jesus explicitly rejects in the gospel, violence and enmity.
Mm. Yeah, well, that's the way I see it as well. And that's one of the motivations for me to have this type of program so that we can raise the contradictions up. Jesus lived a certain way. He taught a certain way. He acted a certain way. He taught a certain way. And the Christian community is to follow that teaching and that action. But the contradiction here is that we are finding the Christian community in one direction, largely, and Christ in another direction. How do we bring the two together?
I tell you, Don, in a community of cannibals, it is awfully difficult to raise the issue that cannibalism is contrary to the will of God. And the reason for that is the entire ethos, the entire atmosphere and value system of the community is literally structured from the cradle, the nurturing that goes on in the cradle, to believe that cannibalism is consistent with the will of God. Mm-hmm. That's where we are at Christianity for the last 1700 years. Generation after generation of Christians have been nurtured in what is fundamentally a falsehood, that you can follow Jesus and put a dagger in someone's heart, that you can follow Jesus and have someone be a lethal enemy. Now, this is more than an intellectual problem. As one of the great biblical scholars, who was the dean of Catholic biblical scholars in the 20th century, Reverend John L. McKenzie, and one of the great biblical scholars of the 20th century, he was the first Catholic ever elected president of the most prestigious biblical society in the world, the Society of Biblical Literature and Exegesis. As he says, if we cannot know from the New Testament that Jesus rejected violence, we can know nothing of his personal message. It's the clearest of teachings. Mm-hmm. He means we cannot know anything about Jesus being Messiah, Christ, Son of the Living God. We can know nothing about Trinity, virgin birth. We can know nothing about Jesus' rejection of adultery. There is nothing clearer in the New Testament than Jesus' rejection of violence and enmity. Yet, for 1700 years, the churches have been engaged in promoting and justifying, indeed, religiously legitimatizing in the name of Jesus, barbarities, cruelties that are beyond imagination. Okay. How can this be possible?
Yes.
This is only possible because of the nurturing that starts in the cradle and comes right through with all the institutions of Christian society telling everyone from the child on up to the adult that this is legitimate. The institution that's primarily responsible for that kind of religious nurturing is the church. You remember way back in 1948, when the play South Pacific was about to go on in Broadway, mm-hmm. that play was not going to go on up to 3 hours before the play went on, because the people in charge of the theater in New York wanted Rodgers and Hammerstein to take out a line. And Rodgers and Hammerstein refused to take out the line, and there was a big legal and economic controversy that was only settled when the theater guild capitulated. Hmm. The line was, you've got to be taught before it's too late.
Yes.
Before you are 6 or 7
or eight,
to hate all the people your relatives hate, you've got to be carefully taught.
Yes.
What we are hardwired into is children. The idea that it's right to be a superhero, to conquer people by domination and violence and destruction. What we're nurtured in as the kind of Christianity that we're told is the real kind of Christianity, which is you can hate people, you can beat people, you can kill people, as long as you're doing it for your country or yeah. your ethnic group.
Yes.
Once that hardwiring takes place, it's more than a rational problem to undo it. Because I will tell you, it is absolutely, positively, without doubt, incontestable in terms of scripture scholarship, that the Jesus of the New Testament rejected violence and enmity in total, so that anyone who's preaching anything differently, he may be preaching about Jesus, but he's not preaching about the Jesus of the New Testament.
Mm-hmm. Well, many it's often said that Jesus saves, but Paul taught. Many of the ministers, if they do go into fundamental ministers or others, if they do go into the New Testament, they'll just kind of skip over Jesus. But mostly they're stuck in the Old Testament glorification of war, and certainly our culture glorifies war, and it's seen so often today, in particularly where the heroes are the warriors, and not the peacemakers. Those that go into dangerous places, armed only with love, those are the heroes in my mind, the people that we should be elevating and celebrating. How can we instruct or change or move away from the culture of violence, particularly for the Christian support of the culture of violence and the culture that blends Christian teachings with nationalistic violence? How can we move that away from that? Give us some suggestions.
You mentioned St. Paul, and St. Paul says, you know, that in Christ there's no Greek or Scythian, male or female, Jew or Gentile.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I happen to notice that here in Atlanta, there's a rather large sign that purports to proclaim the gospel. I believe it is. I know it's put up by Charles Stanley,
mm-hmm.
And the sign is two words: Jesus saves. Except that the S of Jesus and the S of saves are the same letter. They don't have a second S.
I've seen that sign.
So what you have is, you have Jesus saves, and the last letter, the U in Jesus, the S in saves, and the S in Jesus are the same,
mm-hmm.
and then the A in saves.
Mm-hmm.
And then the sign has Jesus saves with USA in red, white, and blue
mm-hmm.
in it. This, in my mind, this, as I can see it by the teaching of Jesus, this is idolatry, outright idolatry. In Christ, there is no American or Iraqi.
Mm-hmm.
There is no Frenchman or Chinaman. We are in Christ, period. And that overrides all nationality and everything else. Our fundamental fidelity in baptism in Christ cannot be to a nation state. It cannot be to an ethnic group. The fundamental overriding fidelity, our orientation to which everything else is subject, everything else, has to be that we are in Christ. Otherwise, what does it mean to say Jesus is Lord?
Yes.
So that what we have is we have a situation where nationalism in the churches almost universally and for a long period of time
yes.
has become an idolatry.
Mm-hmm.
The national interest overrides Jesus' teachings. And that makes no difference whether it's the Orthodox or the Catholics or the Protestants or the Evangelicals or what part of the world we're in. All we have to do, for example, is look at Tsarist Russia to see how this thing works out in terms of the Orthodox Church
mm-hmm.
or any of the others.
Yes.
My point is, in the New Testament, whether it's Jesus or Paul or Peter or anyone else, the state is not an object of redemption. In the New Testament, the state is a totally perishable entity that will cease to exist like the blade of grass. What is imperishable is the human soul, the immortal human being.
Mm-hmm.
What is imperishable is God. What is imperishable is the resurrected Jesus. It is irrational to give our life over to the perishable.
Yes.
And not give it over to the imperishable, to the temporal rather than the eternal. When we place the United States, or Britain, or France, or Russia, whatever the case may be, and their survival over and above the teaching of Jesus, that is, that we have to point blankly choose against Jesus' teachings in order to promote the survival of the totally perishable, that's what's called idolatry.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's signed by Charles Stanley, Jesus USA. Now, I don't know if Charles, I don't know Charles Stanley. I don't know if he speaks English as well as I do, but I know what that sign says to the average person.
Mm-hmm.
It focuses Jesus, Christianity, his teachings on the salvation of the United States, and that is technically, I mean technically, I'm not waving fingers.
Mm-hmm.
That's idolatry.
Mm-hmm.
The United States is not saved eternally, and secondly, Jesus didn't come to save the United States. He came to save humanity.
Yes.
But I don't want to pick on Charles Stanley.
There's a lot of people to pick on this situation.
That's right. And that's just an example. Being a Catholic, perhaps ecumenical etiquette requires that I say something about the Catholic Church.
Okay.
Archbishop of Atlanta, John Donahue, prior to the Iraqi War, publicly, in writing, just like Charles Stanley has publicly stated Jesus saves USA, publicly said the Iraqi war was a just war. Now let me quote you what he says. He says, I think Saddam Hussein does have weapons of mass destruction. I think eventually he would make a preemptive strike on us. At some point you have to say, how much proof do you need? He could have killed thousands of people with a preemptive strike. He has put his own people to death. I think eventually he would make a preemptive strike on us. I don't think human life means anything to him. Well, listen. This is utterly unacceptable by any standards, the standards of Jesus or that moral sleeping pill that's utterly worthless called the just war theory. That never has been applied, can't be applied, and never will be applied to wars.
Mm-hmm.
People have to be accountable for what they say, whether it's Charles Stanley or whether it's the Archbishop. There are now thousands and thousands of people dead, millions living in misery, because these people promoted a war. And by that I mean, when you morally justify a war in the name of God, you become part of the motivating operation for it.
Yes.
You promote it.
Yes.
There's blood.
Yeah.
And so what we have to look at here, Dawn, is this. Where are the weapons of mass destruction under which we brought so much misery to so many people? What does it mean that Saddam would have preemptively struck with weapons of mass destruction when he didn't even use it when he was under threat? What does it mean that Hans Blix, David Kelly, Ritter, all said, people who were there for 10 years all said no such things exist? What does it mean?
Even the Iraqis.
Even the Iraqis
said that they don't exist.
What does it mean that the CIA veteran intelligence people said no such thing exists?
Mm-hmm.
The point is, I'm not trying to wave fingers. I'm trying to say, that this is exactly what happens when we deviate from the motto of every church, a peace church.
Mm-hmm.
We should be about, that is Charles Stanley, myself, the Archbishop should be about one thing, teaching what Jesus taught about violence and enmity.
Mm-hmm.
That's all.
Yes.
That's the only commission we have. Remember, the Great Commission to the Church, as scholars call it, is in the last paragraph of Matthew 20, of the Gospel of Matthew. Go ye therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And we always quote that, and we've done that quite well. There are almost 2 billion Christians in the world. But what's always left out is the next sentence, Don, or the next clause.
Mm-hmm.
And teach them to obey all that I have commanded you. Not all that Aristotle commanded,
mm-hmm.
Not all with Cicero with his just war theory. Not all that George Bush or Clinton or Napoleon or anyone else commanded. I don't have, the bishop doesn't have, Charles Stanley has no commission and no authority to to teach other than what Jesus taught. Mm-hmm. And Jesus taught a way of nonviolent love of friends and enemies.
Yes.
And so I would ask them very, 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 very explicitly, is it not so that if you want to be a witch burner in good Christian conscience, mm-hmm. all you have to do is prove that Jesus would have burnt witches. Mm. But if you can't prove Jesus would have burnt witches, you have absolutely no business as a Christian burning witches or proclaiming that mm-hmm. in terms of being consistent with the teaching of Jesus.
Yes.
Is it possible that Jesus would have said what Charles Stanley said, what the Archbishop and millions upon tens of millions of other Christians have said in relationship to this particular war, the Iraqi one, or for that matter, for the last 1,700 years right. of popes, patriarchs, Luther, Calvins, Wigley, whatever, Henry VIII, mm-hmm. all justifying and having their bishops and their mm-hmm. priests justify going out and killing people in the name of Jesus and simultaneously in the name of the self-interest of the local political bosses.
Yes. Well, it's certainly a collaboration between the political finding the its collaborators on the faith side to support the evil that's being done in so many parts of the world, and at home in terms of the economic oppression, the devotion of resources away from people and into machines of destruction, requires support of people who claim to be people of faith, because there's a lot of people of faith. The question is, how are they being led? Are they being led to support the nonviolent, loving way of Jesus Christ, as it's plainly set out in the Gospels, or are they being led in some misdirected way to support the economic wheels that the military and the political worlds must have in order to survive? That's why we have this show. That's why we have this program, to raise these issues, to discuss them in
Well, we must make this, that it's absolutely clear. There is an intimate and irrevocable connection between wealth and violence. You cannot have more than you need to live while other people don't have the necessities of life unless you got the gun. Mm-hmm. Because when someone's watching their child suffer and die because of disease or hunger or psychological things, huh? Mm-hmm. And someone else is out there in Las Vegas spending $10,000 a night or $1,000 a night mm-hmm. or diddling around with fashion and so forth and so on, yeah. The only way that you can keep luxury in a world that doesn't, where people to the tune of one person every 9 seconds dies of starvation in this world, mm-hmm. and that's not reported like 911, and that's more people that die every day of starvation than die to 911. The only way you can keep luxury in a world where there's absolute necessity, where people don't have, is you've got to have violence. Mm-hmm. And hence, when we look, if you remember, back before this Iraqi thing started, there was no money around to do, for example, everyone knows when you have people who are economically deprived, children need small classes with almost private tutoring. They need longer days in school. There was no money for teachers for that sort of thing. Yeah. None, zero. Yeah. But the minute war comes, there's billions, hundreds of billions available. Yeah. Uh-huh. What this is an and there are churches and Christians justifying it. Mm-hmm. And there are Christians and churches ignoring the mm-hmm. other situation. Mm-hmm. So what this comes down to is this. Remember, Jesus at the last says the standard for the last judgment is not whether you're Catholic, Protestant, Orthodox, Evangelical. The standard is, I was hungry and you gave me to eat, thirsty. The standard is mercy.
Yes.
Or I wasn't hungry, or I was hungry and you did not, in mercilessness. Mm-hmm. The works of war are utterly and completely inconsistent at every level with the works of mercy, and therefore can never be instruments of salvation, or nor can war ever glorify the God made visible by Jesus, the Father who is rich in mercy.
Well, Father McCarthy, how can is what is the hope here to move the Protestants, the Catholics, the evangelicals, the people of who claim to be Christ? How can we find hope that this body of Christians can move towards, is there hope that we can move towards the teachings of the nonviolent Jesus?
The question you raise is a critical question, because it can be superficially answered and said, of course, there's always hope. The reality is that evil, as the fathers of the church say, is the mystery of evil is only one inch shorter than the mystery of God. It has depth and power to it that we can't imagine. Mm. And once we begin to cover evil with kind of a divine canopy, we put it under divine patronage, then it's almost impossible to stop, because we're now doing evil in the name of God. So this is what I have to respond to that, Don. I have to say the hope is one place and one place only. Christ is risen. He has conquered evil, and by the power of his cross and resurrection, he has sent out the power and the wisdom. He has made it available to human beings to access. Hmm. I don't believe that the Charles Stanleys and the Archbishop Donahue's are malicious people, are people intentionally doing evil. I think they're in a state of non-culpable ignorance, as I was when I joined the Marine Corps. Mm. I didn't see it. Therefore, our hope is in prayer, in proclamation of what the truth of the nonviolent Jesus is in his nonviolent way, in the hope that the grace of the cross and resurrection will permeate souls, will harden, will get beyond this incrustation of 1,700 years of nurturing, and wake up the churches, and especially their leadership, wake them up to the truth.
Well, Father,
what God is.
Thank you so much for being with us. If you want more information about, again, this is a one of two parts, so watch this program and come back next week, and we'll pick more up about what we have to say about following the nonviolent Jesus. Thank you for being with us. I'm Don Edwards, Every Church, a Peace Church.
How long will it take till we realize we made a big mistake? If we turn our back on us, how long will it be till the world can finally see? Turn their back on love from one to another. It's time to uncover the meaning of it all. So here it is. We are here, 'cause we are family, living all together, seed of shining seed. We are here.